I'm here with Michael Wilson, and we're talking about the Planetary Architecture 2 folio that Zaha Hadid produced through the AA in 1983. And we're going to be exploring a lot of the ideas within it and then looking in much more detail at the whole process of the work within it. So maybe, Michael, we could discuss the background to the exhibition, to the folio, which of course was the winning of the Peak in 1983.
Of course, trying to remember everything, we're going back 40 years, so it's, but it was quite a dramatic time. You know, it was exciting to be at the Architectural Association then. And when I was a student, with Zaha my fourth year, and then with Peter Wilson my fifth year, but I had a critique with Zaha in my fifth year, which was really exciting for both of us. And I think it was really because of that that she invited me to work with her when I graduated. So arriving at her studio that summer in 1982, it was just Alistair Standing and myself. Alistair was another student who had just finished, and we were beginning to work on the Peak competition right then and there. I'll mention that the studio, of course, was Zaha's little muse house in South Kensington. And so we worked away and, you know, tried to get that submission in time. A number of people came in to help with that Peak submission. So even though in the summer it was just Alistair and I and Zaha, it was a matter of weeks, I think, that Zaha and Alistair and I were working on the project before she got another, you know, group in. I think it was Nabil and Jonathan Dunn, who had been Zaha's office the year before. They came in, Wendy Galway came in to help with some of the paintings, I believe. The initial competition submission was mainly black and white drawings, ink drawings. I think we did a few of the perspectives in color, but I'd have to see the original competition submission. So it was submitted at the last minute. In fact, Jonathan Dunn reminded me recently that we almost failed to submit the competition entry. What happened back in those days, you know, nothing was electronic. It was all the competitions, architectural competitions, were mailed. They were posted in. There was one post office in London in those days that stayed open till midnight, and that was down in Leicester's Trafalgar Square.
St. Martin's Lane,
yeah, just off Trafalgar Square. And so Jonathan Dunn, who had a car, and I rushed down there to submit the competition literally minutes before midnight. And Jonathan remembered that when we walked in to the post office, there were another group or a number of other architects that we recognized also submitting their projects. So that was that. So,
so the rest, I guess, this is history. We know that Zaha won, and we're going to get into that in much more detail. But maybe it's interesting to talk a little bit more about, you know, Zaha's practice, how she worked. I mean, obviously, she was pretty much fresh out of the AA, having studied with Rem and Ilya, and then beginning to teach on her own. I believe that was your first year.
Yeah.
But the kind of Zaha, that period of Zaha, which many would argue is her most creative period, certainly in terms of, you know, drawing and also sort of ideas and research, is very, very different to the ZHA that we know today, which is, you know, almost a corporate scale when we're looking at buildings going across the world. So it's interesting, perhaps, you know, and also I think when I did this thread later, like 88, 89, when I think you were still in the office, when you worked with Zaha, she was very much there. She would sing, she would scream, she would shout, you would eat with her. It was a kind of, shall we say, an immersive experience.
Definitely. Yeah, no, it was very much like that. But it was even like that as a student of hers as well. I think the AA, the Architectural Association, was like that in the late 70s. It was very much, you were in a family, your unit, you chose your unit, you chose your tutor, and you stayed with them for the year, and you didn't have any other classes. You had occasional lectures, but there were really no other classes. So you were immersed in that family, which was your tutor, your professor. And Zaha loved it. I mean, she embraced that way of working. You know, you'd sit around a table with drawings. Obviously, this is all pre-computer, so it was a, you know, drawings and reams of trace paper, and everyone would be going through their project proposals. The AA was quite an exciting hotbed of really new ideas about how architecture could be created and how it could be presented. And I think that's something that was really exciting. I actually started my architecture schooling at Cornell University in the United States, which was very engineering oriented. And I'm grateful for that because it taught me how to really become very proficient in using the ink pens and drafting on Mylar, which is what we did. So arriving at the AA, I had that technical ability, which wasn't really taught at the time. You know, you had to kind of learn it yourself. But what was done at the AA was a lot of new ways of looking at how to present architectural drawings. And that was, you know, an abstraction of the axonometric or abstracted isometrics, and paintings, using paintings as a form of examination. You know, architecture has a history of... Sorry, go ahead.
So just as a background of what was going on, I mean, there was Zaha teaching fresh out of, you know, Roman Aelius' staple, shall we say. There was Peter Wilson, who was kind of much more, shall we say, atmospheric drawings, more perspective-based, as opposed to Zaha's kind of more constructivist-based drawings.
Yeah.
Peter
yeah.
Cook and his lot... Nigel Coates, coming out of Bernard Tschumi's studio, Dip 10, who incidentally Bernard had just won Parc La Villette the same year as Peak. So we had this, you had this whole coming together of a lot of very different drawing styles. I mean, you know, and also the competition and the discussions and the debates between these different positions.
Well, they didn't come together. You use the word coming together, and they never came together because every unit was a very isolated experience. And I'm sure that made it very difficult for the external examiners because they had to start to address, you know, how these paintings and this painterly architecture was fulfilling the requirements of an architecture school. And it was happening, but it was interesting.
There's a real sense in Zaha's work about this period of this, and I think Alvin says it in the introduction. He said, your drawings and paintings seem to transcend the subject matter. They appear to be some form of research. So there was very much in the work we're going to be looking at this notion of reinvestigating modernism, looking in particular at all the constructivists and suprematists. I'm thinking about Leonidov, Melnikov, Lissitzky. And obviously the title, Planetary Architecture, of the folio, comes direct from this. Also, we've been talking about Niemeyer as well. So there's something about weightlessness, the 0 degree of gravity that Zaha was looking about this period.
I think you could see that in her fourth year and fifth year architecture projects for her, you know, university projects, that Malevich tecton over the Thames, and the way, in fact, the next project that she did also related to this constructivist format.
Okay, so and so we've got this background of stuff, and then Zaha wins the Peak, and at that moment, I think Alvin, particularly, the AA's galvanized. Everything goes into all the resources. It felt at the time that the AA went into helping her launch this career, making a huge exhibition in the exhibition gallery and the front members' room, and also the folio, which again came out of Alvin's idea of publications, and this was going to be the second folio. The first one in the same year was by Danny Liebskin called Chamberworks, and the basic format for the folio was designed together with a really well-known graphic designer called Lorraine Wild out of Los Angeles. But just speak a little bit, Michael, about that atmosphere. I know that the top of the became the painting studio to make the paintings for the exhibition, and also turning to the world, which is on the cover of the folio.
The interesting thing about the Architectural Association at that time was that it wasn't like any other university. I mean, I'd been at Cornell. I remember when I went to look for what university I was going to go to, I went to a number of schools in the United States. They were all what you consider a university. The Architectural Association was three 18th century London townhouses that had been put together to create a school, you know, in the middle of central London. So already you're in a kind of family setting. There was a bar, there was a restaurant, and these were really the hubs of the social activity at the Architectural Association. And you would have professors in there, you'd have visiting tutors in there, and you'd have students in there. Everyone would be, you know, jumbled up together. There was one main staircase which everyone passed each other. In fact, that's where I remember seeing Zaha the first time. She was actually a friend of one of the students because, you know, she had just graduated. The years were very, very close. So a friend, a fellow who I became a friend with was a friend of hers. He'd been mentioning Zaha, you know, so she was very recognizable. Zaha had quite a strong character, as did a lot of people at the Architectural Association. So you've got this hub of activity, this sort of wild family house that people are living in and working in and 24 hours in the studios. And then Zaha wins, and Alvin, who's your father? Just in case people don't make that connection, you know, Alvin was very close. Zaha was very close to Alvin. I think he really appreciated what she was doing for the school, what all of the architects were doing, all of those people at the time.
Zaha Hadid, a student in the unit, and perhaps is the best example of a large number of students who took on the problem of going back to the painters, sculptors, architects of the 20s and taking off from where they left. The Peak, a competition won by Zaha Hadid for a club in Hong Kong, is typical of the verve and energy and style of this group.
But it was, you know, he wanted this exhibition to be something that was important for Zaha and important for the Architectural Association. And I know he had in the back of his mind that he was going to do one of the planetary, one of the, you know, the publications, those portfolios on the work. For him to give us, you know, he gave Zaha the whole upper floor of the rear of the building to have as her private studio for a number of months. You know, it must have been a bit of a scandal going on behind the scenes. I can only imagine. You know, there we were working away 24/7, and that's when she really got a whole group of students and people to come in to work on the paintings, because there were numerous paintings created for the exhibition and drawings.
And the whole technique of painting, I mean, there was a lot of Zaha talking about tick-ticks and whooshes, and also all the different film canisters, the slightly different shades of grey. She was, and you would see Zaha with a hair, you know, with a delicate paintbrush and a sort of hair dryer, watercoloring or adding acrylic to stretched boards and things.
Yeah, well, the process at the time was, again, this is all pre-computer. The drawings, I did the majority of the drawings, and they would then be transferred using transfer carbon paper. Onto a stretched piece of watercolor paper, huge or small, whatever the size. Sheets of the watercolor paper were wet and then stretched onto boards, taped down, and then we transferred the drawings onto these, and then they were painted. So the painters used film canisters because they created their own colors. And it was not just lots of shades of gray, it was lots of shades of every color, really. Now, the film canisters were just all over the place. And I remember, you know, every time there was always a constant need for these canisters. There were, as you say, thousands of them, it seems. And anytime anyone went out the door, Zaha would shout, you know, go by the photograph shop and get some of the canisters, because they were used film canisters that we, you know, the small round canisters that we'd use for the paint. So it was a pretty hectic
time. So Michael, 1982, you were working with Zaha, you were working on The Peak, and then one of the next big projects you worked on was the drawing The World, which is the cover, or a screen print of it, is the cover of Planetary Architecture 2. And this is, you know, in many ways, it's an extraordinary drawing. It's charting out Zaha's career to date, mentioning seven key projects, drawing them in a really interesting kind of collage way. And it's also, like this is my world. You know, it's a confidence in the drawing which talks about moving forward and don't you agree?
Oh, completely. Completely.
You talk through the project because she's showing on in the drawing.
The idea came from this beautiful, inspiring little, you know, post-it size sketch. I did think it rather strange that she wanted to do an image of the world with the Zaha projects. But we had a long discussion about how, you know, I thought to set it out and to create the world, because her image was just a part of the horizon. So I believe, you know, the idea of cutting the earth and having it basically, you see the curve, and yet the curve is implied and part of the landscape, but then it's going back to something that I played with, which is the idea of the earth being flat and everything falls off the edge of the earth. So that's where that sort of void comes into play, which also allows us the opportunity to abstract images and to play with the idea of elements floating. So that sort of line where everything is floating gives you the chance to cast shadows as well. So on the far left, you can see her project for the Irish Prime Minister's house, the competition, which is over the sticking over the edge. And then on the far right, you've got Zaha's student project, Museum of the 19th Century, which is also crossing the Thames, but again, it then falls off the edge of the world, as you will. The main landscape was sort of a composition that was used with the River Thames and then the waterway going through the site of the park La Villette. So the main landscape shows the sort of park La Villette, which was used to merge with London. So left, you've got London, and then as it starts to go across the landscape, it becomes the Park La Villette, which was a landscape project. And it was
We also looking at the project for her brother, the Eaton Square.
Yes.
And then, of course, the Peak is in the top left-hand corner.
Yeah.
Now, it's interesting, in the interview that Alvin has in the folio with Zaha, they're going through the project. They're sort of going through the development of her career. Mm. They're talking about, you know, how she uses drawing as research, and she's looking into the suprematist constructivist origins of the 20th century and how she can kind of reinvigorate that. And then at some point, she talks about this notion of researching explosions. And she's talking about the Irish Prime Minister's house, which to me, I think is key. It's like a real shift from OMA. And she's talking about explosions, and that's, she was interested in things shattering and, I guess, floating around in some sort of zero gravity condition.
Well, the idea of an explosion, I mean, I don't remember explosions as a term that we bandied about in the studio, either in the studio of her practice or the studio of the AA, because it was all to do with movement. And if you think of the way, the idea of explosion is that it's more of an explosion of ideas and thoughts. the actual elements were the creation of objects intersecting and hitting each other. If you want to refer to it as an explosion, I suppose it could be seen that way. I don't know that the mindset was so much explosion as the term was used. We did exploded isometrics, exploded axonometrics. It was more a matter of dissection, rather than it was the excitement of an explosion rather than the danger or negative aspects. It was only looking at the positive aspects of explosion. And yes, it was a part.
Yeah, it's interesting. Alvin says to her, what do you mean when you talk about the notion of explosion? Mm. This is talking about the Prime Minister's house. And she said, it's in these moments when she collides things together, things begin to burst. I had a longing to do something which was not an accepted type, to break certain barriers. So I guess she's trying to break out of her, the background of OMA. And we, if we look at earlier drawings, like the Dutch Parliament, which is also in the catalogue, it's really interesting. It's kind of taking the exploded axo/iso to a new level.
Absolutely.
I think, isn't it?
Absolutely. Well, that was something that was really interesting about the drawings that were coming out of the OMA studio at the time. And it was really, stretching what an architectural drawing was all about. And, it was really taking the elements and almost isolating them so that you could really examine them. So explosion was used, and we certainly exploded things, but it was always a gravitational sense of the word explosion rather than a dynamite and fire.
Kenneth Frampton writes the sort of foreword to the catalogue in the folio. And it's titled Kufic Suprematism. So he's talking about the script, the Arab script, and he's suggesting that obviously there's a strong influence of the Middle East and there's the kind of calligraphy of the plan and stuff. And he's talking about how that she's plugging this background of growing up in the Middle East, studying in Beirut, into her kind of critique of modernism. And also he talks about hedonism world. He talks about hedonism, the world of pleasure. I think that's a word that obviously came from Rem. But there was a lot of talk about the metropolitan world, hedonism. And then he also, and I think this is interesting because I think when we move to talk about the peak, it's interesting to remember these things. But Kenneth Frampton also talks about the sort of erotic implication in the peak. He talks about the erotics as being suspended in a vast, luxurious, starlit void at night above the distant panorama of the city and the sea, the scintillating paradise of the world. So there's something about Zaha's work which is always about engaging with the city, engaging with a certain lifestyle, and engaging with possibilities. She loved flying, I think the aerial views, but it was also a kind of, architecture was extremely generous, I think, in terms of engaging with the public and making public spaces, making landscapes. I just wondered how this conversation maybe came around the peak.
Well, it came around all of the work that we did those years and in the early years of the practice. The landscape was always a part of the study. And, I've mentioned I was a student of Zaha's. In fact, my year with Zaha was the first year of her teaching on her own. And the projects we did were urban projects. I remember it was a project, we had Berlin, it was the city we went to. But I think it was the next year that she began her really in-depth studies of the East End, the Docklands area of London. And that was a major, a major research project for her and her students for a number of years. Zaha's idea of urbanism included a very, very public access to the projects. And I think that was really something that went through her work for many, many years in the early years of the studio. The peak, one of the main reasons for that void in the middle was to allow the public who were driving along the access road a view through to the view of the view beyond. I mean, that was part of the reason to do it. It was as private a project as you could get. You know, it was a private club on the top of the mountain. At the very top of the peak is a place where everyone, you know, the public, went to look at the view. So you'd have these closed off properties all the way up there. And this one was one of the closest to the top. So the views were really stunning. And for Zaha to think, okay, well, this is going to be open and the landscape was going to be open to everyone to view, was quite a gesture to make.
Yeah, and I think that there, a lot of, certainly in teaching work, that, I mean, when I was a student with her, and there was a very much an emphasis on the research into the city, the spaces, the possibilities, the potentials of the city, unused spaces, derelict areas. And I remember my fourth year, we worked in the Royal Docks, which now is a busy airport and a whole development. Mm-hmm. The university at the time, it was empty. So she was kind of seeking out these unknown bits of the city and trying to bring them back into the city. Talk about openness.
It was a very early research. As I mentioned, my year as her student, she wasn't examining that, but I believe it started the next year when she really went into the East End and the Docklands of London, which were completely abandoned areas, as you mentioned. And those studies about how these urban landscapes, deserted landscapes, could become an invigorated and lively, you know, inhabited part of the city. Those studies went through beyond London. You know, we went to Hamburg to do a project, an invited competition to study the Docklands in Hamburg before they were developed. You know, this was so it was certainly a theme and a consideration that she took in all of the projects, how the ground condition can work with the public, no matter what the project was.
So, Michael, when we look at the box after the catalogue piece, we're looking at Zaha's fourth year project, which is very much, it's a redrawing, an animation, should we say, an occupation of the Malevich tectonic that she's turned into a bridge structure that's crossing the Thames. But there's a lot going on in this image, isn't there?
It's a particularly interesting project because of the way she took a very literal aspect of a Malevich painting and inserted into it an architectural program that would benefit the city. And I think she said that she was quite interested in how that program could work as an inhabited bridge over the River Thames. And that's actually interesting because it's harking back to the 15th century, I believe, when there were inhabited bridges across the River Thames. And I think what's exciting is that it's literally a Malevich tecton. I mean, it's the only time she took that, but it's interesting that it's the first time that she literally tried to take the painting and turn it into a three-dimensional architectural program. A very interesting study.
And this is relevant when we talk about the peak, because this is packed with programs, isn't it? I'm thinking about the plans where, I believe it's a hotel, where, you know, there's a hotel, there's a club, it's a mixed-use, kind of very densely programmed structure.
Yeah.
But also, what's going on in the bottom left of the image? We're looking at all these floating suprematist images.
I think what she's done there is literally deconstructed the Malevich construction. And created a composition of her own as a painting, because it doesn't relate to the project itself.
So there's this imagination, which we go back to the world, where there's the project, the proposal, and then there's a kind of desire, the research, the speculation about what she's done that she then looks at in another way.
And what's interesting is the deconstruction of the Malevich tecton as a painterly presentation.
So then, you know, if we go to, you know, to the really the painting of the peak, which you just won the competition. You've been working all summer with a team of people making these paintings. And I remember it from the show. It's like 2 meters tall. It's really a big, big painting.
I think it's closer to 3 meters. Yeah.
Because there's that photograph of you and Alistair standing in front.
Yeah. Right?
So it's a huge, big painting. Mm. I remember coming into the exhibition room and thinking, well, where's the project? What am I looking at? Because when you look at it carefully, the peak is a tiny little, almost a blob at the top. So what's going on here? What was the idea about this image?
The peak painting started from a photograph of Hong Kong. I remember, and I haven't seen it in decades. I don't know where it is. But I think Zaha had this photograph of Hong Kong basically looking at this aspect of it. And she said, let's make this into a sort of an exploded kind of isometric sort of view, perspective, everything. So I abstracted the photograph, obviously, got rid of the nature and created the landscape where we could show the Peak project in situ over Hong Kong. And then Zaha had the idea to explode the floor plans of the project and place them over the buildings or over created buildings towards the bay or along the bay, just to show it. And there, if you look at the drawing, you can see that they're arranged according to their relation, their height relation. So you have the highest elements at the left, and as it goes down, you're getting into the lower levels of the project. No one, I think, really looks at it and says, oh yes, there's the project. It's really meant to be just a very powerful presentation of the project commanding the whole city.
Yeah, and I mean, what's interesting, I mean, I'm looking at the painting and then looking at the way it's been rendered and colored and stuff, and then looking at her interview with Alvin, where she says about, I think it's at La Villette, but she's also talking about the peaks. She said, I don't like nature very much. I think that a landscape is not purely to do with a park. And anybody who goes to Hong Kong, when you fly in, you see these mountains covered with greenery. You know, it's in some ways, a kind of landscape paradise. So let's talk a little bit more about exposing the tectonics of plates and the geometry of the landscape that you're doing here. What was behind that?
A very simple. Plants hide architecture. So there's really no reason to draw. I mean, if we were to put plants in there, you'd never see the Peak project, or you'd see it peaking above the peak. In the late 70s, early 80s, architects did not think that much of trees unless you were working with a landscape architect somewhere. But it wasn't something we considered. And I certainly was of that view, having started at Cornell, where it was about an engineering style of architecture, moving on to the AA, where we did not, especially in Zaha's unit, we did not learn to love nature. But it was dealing with a control of nature. And so the painting, it was dealing with the landscape, and the landscape is based on the hard elements of the ground and the earth and the rocks.
But also I think that there's something, this and the other painting in the folio, there's something most geological about it. It's about rock formations and the way that the peak is partly embedded in the rocks and partly, you know, shattered and floating above. So there's something about that which reads here. Now, we talked also earlier about the production of this painting a little bit, the numbers of colours, the numbers of different shades of grey or blue or whatever that Zaha worked with. How long did this painting take to make, and how many people were involved in it? What was the process?
Well, how many people can you fit crawling on top of a 9-foot by 5-foot panel? I think that's basically what it came down to in the end of the day. The process with all of the paintings was to create a line drawing first, and then stretch a watercolor paper onto a board, and then use carbon transfer paper, which came in A4 size, and we would spread it all out over the stretched watercolor paper, unroll the drawing, the line drawing on top of it, and trace over the whole thing. So it was a rather laborious process. And then the painters came in, and Zaha would always have her idea in her head what she wanted the image to sort of convey. And with the peak, she very strongly had these ideas of blues and oranges, and you can see in the color studies how that was examined. The sort of gray tones and oranges and blues, and the final result was as you see.
And you have some of these color studies, don't you?
Yes, you can see the color studies here, yeah.
And this was an exhaustive process. I mean, my memory is that many, many, many iterations were made. It's not...
Of the color?
Yeah, of the color sketches and studies and stuff. That was a kind of iterative process.
Usually, yes. But, I mean, of the color studies, there were four of these studies done. I have two of them. The other two have disappeared. So, you know, it was what was exhausted was developing all of the tones once the paintings, the large ones especially, were ready.
So you said as many people as could crawl over a huge.
Yeah, floor. I mean, I think, I know Nan and Nikki and Wendy were all working on that large. Canvas, and I'm not sure who else was there. I think there were a couple of other painters involved. You know, there were a lot of people upstairs at the Architectural Association in that back room where we were working away. A lot of people. So.
Right. Well, it's certainly an amazing image, and it's kind of burnt itself into my retina years ago. Let's just look at, before we look at other paintings, I think it's interesting to look at the plans. And in the catalogue to the folio, there's a few floor plans.
Yeah.
But this is another language entirely, isn't it? Well, we've got Zaha, you know, making these exploded ISOs and creating an urban landscape, a big expansive vision.
Mm.
Plans are highly detailed and choreographed, inked. You know, I know they came out of those sketches, and then there was a process of refining this, of inking it, and markings, and notating. But we're looking at, you know, incredibly ornate calligraphies of movements. How are these drawings generated?
Well, we had the beams, and we had the program. The site itself led to the development of the elements in the void, the curve ramp, which takes you into the project. The program of the health club mainly was set into the hillside. I mean, if you look at the jagged edges that come out of part of the plans there, those are the elements of the club, of the health club. The beams mainly were the apartments. The two lower levels were meant to be apartments, duplex apartments, and then a level of apartments for sale, to be sold, developer apartments. The upper two beams, the penultimate beam was for the promoters' families, and the top beam was the promoters, directly the promoters' penthouse.
But there's other things going on. There's like curvatures. And I'm looking in the catalogue. First of all, they lay out the plans of Parc La Villette, and underneath that, plan for the peak, and it's a different scale, but you can read a landscape proposal as the building below. It's interesting. Do you remember all those pistolets, French curves that we used to get?
There was one French curve, which we found at a unit trip to Paris. It was from a shop in Paris, and it was the office parakeet, we called it. And it's the only one that I ever used, and it's the only one that I allowed people to use. So I think we bought up the whole shop and used it. There were a couple of larger ones, but they were never quite as good. you could always create any curve, no matter how long, using this one particular power key.
I remember, and that was the process of inking and
yep.
the lines perfectly. So there was an incredible precision about realizing this line work,
yep.
wasn't that?
Well, yeah, ink drawings was an architect's art.
And before computers and CAD and
absolutely.
All this stuff, the whole thing about cleaning the nibs of the rotrings and getting the flow right, it's a complete headache if I think back.
Nightmare. I mean, yeah, it's a process that basically it's like taking apart a computer every day to clean the nibs of your pens.
And soaking them overnight when you weren't using them.
Yeah.
It's well behind us.
Yep.
But you know, I think the drawings are more precise than anything you'd get now from that point of view. But talking about the French curves or whatever we call them, it reminds me that Isasaki, who was actually the judge of this competition,
yes.
made his own French curves out of Marilyn Monroe's body shapes.
Hmm.
I don't know that story. So
I don't.
All my architecture is based on Marilyn Monroe.
How's that done for him, I wonder? Well, he's done okay.
Interesting. But in the plans also, there's also kind of like the ink. It's hard to see in the booklet, but there's a lot of kind of whooshing, or what Zaha used to call whooshing. So, you know, dots would then form up and become bigger fields of ink.
The whoosh was a graphic technique to create a movement. It was a breakdown of solid to void, and that was, you would take the pen, create a solid, and then literally a pointillist technique that would gradually disperse the dots, which creates a sense of movement. That was whooshing.
Which is also, I think, interesting to talk about is the other odd, you know, markings on the plans, which I think she called tick ticks or something. And then at another scale of her work, she was looking at, and with you, I think, you're developing furniture pieces, which I've always thought generated from these tick ticks as a kind of shorthand for how you occupy the space.
Tick ticks, potato chips, we called, where it's not in here in this plan, but you can see it in the perspective of the top floor of the peak. There's two sort of floating amorphic forms, which are canopies over. One was at the end was over the pool. The other one was over a space up the upper area. Anyway, Zaha referred to those as potato chips, the forms.
So that plate, which is in the folio, which has some kind of overlay orange and green on it, is extremely abstracted, isn't it? It's a kind of deconstruction of the project to just show very few elements. I think it's called, the title of it is
Promoter's Penthouse and Diving Board.
What was the conversation like?
No conversation. We just wanted to get a view of the promoter's penthouse and the diving board. Very simple. And you can see that it's the potato chip that I was referring to was a floating, not literally, obviously, but it was a cantilever platform, cover, canopy, that would cover part of the shade, part of the area outside the living space of the... This is the promoter's, you know, suite apartment. And he had an infinity edge pool and the diving board. I didn't bother to show the details of how the diving board was constructed, but that's basically the placement of the diving board.
So that's really interesting. So these, they're not quite perspectives, but these renderings or images of the project are worlds away from our current practice, which is to make a computer model and then to cut through and take views. This is something very different, which we can see in plates, say 8 and 9, where we're looking at two similar views, similar viewpoints, but different.
Mm.
I guess somewhere in the rocks, looking up at the peak.
It's an excavated area. We excavated the site along the site boundary, the road that goes up to the peak. So we dropped. We excavated it all to the lowest level in that back area. So actually what you're looking at there, number eight, is the, it's called the elements of the void, and you're standing at the lowest level of the project, basically. And you're looking up underneath the ramp that you drive across to get into the building from the street. And you see the platforms, the entrance platform, which is on the left, the right floating element there is the library, and then there's the beams above are the one beam is a swimming pool.
Then we look at plate nine, which superficially looks quite similar, but it's actually a completely different positioning, isn't it?
It's a slightly different positioning, yes. Plate nine is just to examine a little bit more closely those elements in the void. They're a bit more detailed. And what's interesting, of course, is that, you know, as these were not done on a computer, you know, you've got the luxury today of deciding, let's take a view here and, oh, let's take it from a couple of feet over, and you can get it like that, you know, like that. Obviously, pre-computer, it was all done by eye. So when I was looking at the building, I would have to imagine, well, first of all, you know, what am I trying to explain in the drawing here? You know, Zaha said, well, let's try to look into the void more. So there would be a number of perspective points that I would try to take, sketching out on you know, trace paper. And then I would discuss that with Zaha, and she said, no, let's go with this one, or let's go with that one.
They weren't sort of classically constructed perspectives either. I mean, I remember, you know, when you tried to do those in those days, there was a horizon line, and you extract everything out, and there's always a kind of detailed grid. These are more intuitive, impressionistic.
I don't think it's a matter of those days. I think there's a way of doing perspectives, which is was always done and still is done. If you want to construct an accurate, proper perspective, you're taught that there's vanishing points. It's either 2 points or 3 points. So I learned those techniques in school, you know, way back in school. So that wasn't the question. But what I was trying to do was to convey a sense of the movement of the architecture and the gestures that we were trying to convey with these, you know, dramatic forms and shapes. And so I distorted things as I felt would give, you know, movement and power to the image. And also it would be to point out what we're trying to examine, the areas we're trying to examine. A number of years after the Peak competition, we went to the offices, Zaha and I went to the offices of OVR, who we'd been working with from day one. She'd always had all the projects with them. And they were testing how their computers would create a perspective view. So we sent them the information before, not by computers. We actually did not email anything over. We took drawings, printed drawings over to them. They then plotted those drawings onto their computers, which were filling an entire room. And they came up with this print of a perspective view. I can't remember what the project was, but we looked at it. Zaha and I both looked at each other, and we sort of shook our heads and said, thank you. The computer in those days wasn't able to create the distortions that the human hand can do. And I'm sure you can, today, of course, you can program whatever distortions you want, but then it wasn't possible.
That's, and then, you know, you're reminding me of the interview with Alvin in the Catalog, where, you know, he's teasing out this notion of weightlessness and gravity-defying architecture. And she then talks about the Peak, and she says, I'm quoting Zaha, she says, the project for me is the notion of floating elements within a given space. And then she goes on to say, I almost believed that there was such a thing as zero gravity. I can actually now believe that buildings can float. I know they don't, but I almost believe. So she, you know, there's this kind of, it's coming from pure constructivism, pure Malevich and stuff, that the elements are floating in a world, they're connected, they're programmed, but they're weightless.
It was an architecture she wanted to create, and it was possible. It would have been possible. Had the Peak Project gone ahead, it would have been an impressive construction, I think, for its time.
But what did the promoter think? What happened when you won the project? And I guess they were looking at the feasibility of building it. Was that, did you get to that level of detail project?
We started with that level of detail. We did the original initial competition entry alongside Ovi Arabs. So we knew it was going to be a Virendal structure to create the forms that we wanted to create. So that wasn't really a question. The project didn't go ahead because in 1983, Margaret Thatcher went to Hong Kong and pointed out the fact that Hong Kong was going to be returned to China in 19, whenever it was. And immediately the economy there collapsed. The developer of the Peak Project lost all of his money. So nothing happened. It just ended overnight.
So, Michael, there's a particular favorite of mine in the folio, which is a really intimate view. It's the view of the divers right at the end, of two divers plunging off one of the beams into a beam of water. And it really encapsulates, you know, a lot about the hedonism that Zaha's work involved at the time, that Frampton talks about. There's certain sort of, he talks again about this kind of poetic and the erotic implications of you know, diving off one place into the other, into the void. It's a really iconic image. Tell us a bit about, you know, what was behind the fruition of this. What were you thinking?
For me, one of at university, it was very important. The book Delirious New York was a very powerful and inspiring tool. And one of my favorite images in that book was the painting by Madeleine Vriesendorp. I think it's called Boxers Eating Oysters, something to that effect, which is just, I mean, how is this architecture, one has to ask, you know, yet it's so inspiring. And that's always been in my mind since I was a student. That's always been in my mind. And when we were putting together these images for the Peak, I just thought it would be really exciting to show this pool. You know, Zaha always loved the idea of water. In fact, it was in her work since she started working on the Thames with the Malevich project. She carried on over the years dealing with that. And you can see that, of course, in her first major London architecture build project, which was the Olympic Pools. So for me, when we were doing these Peak drawings, I wanted to capture this essence of the water, and the idea that one of those beams was a swimming pool was just, you know, pretty exciting. We put changing rooms all along one edge of that beam, which you can see in one of the other perspective views in the portfolio. And obviously your divers aren't going to be diving like this, but neither are your boxers going to be eating oysters with their boxing gloves on. So there's a certain amount of liberty that one can take. This view is quite abstracted. Obviously, I'm showing the angular mouth that's sort of upper right. That's the health club. That's the elements of the club that were built sort of into the mountainside. The pool beam is roughly in relation to the, you know, it's sort of, it's not that wrong. I mean, the divers come out of nowhere because obviously your divers aren't going to be diving in that position, but that's the way they appeared. And I think Zaha loved it because she did a couple of painted variations of this piece.
Well, it's interesting you mentioned Delirious New York and that amazing image. I think it's the Downtown Athletics Clubs. It's the same program in a sense. And also it's interesting because obviously a lot of Zaha's work was influenced so much by Ome, not just Rem, but I think Ilya and Madeline Wiesendorf, Zoe Vangelis, and their whole development of this culture of painting. So, but again, this peak paintings are, I think, a departure from the Ome type of drawings, which are always, I find them quite stiff. They're very narrative and they're very fixed views. And here I think you see a really open-ended, dynamic, and spatial composition coming into the painting. And it, you know, I think this is one of the very few drawings where we actually see a painting. So we see a person. It's the only drawing I can recall where we see a person in any of, you know, Zaha's drawings about or painting that period.
We didn't put people in. We knew they'd have a good time. And it would work.